Assalamu alaikum, dear students. I'm hoping and I'm praying that you are good and fine and taking care of yourself and everybody around you, because that's an essential nowadays. And I really hope that you are catching up with these lectures on time. Especially this chapter is very important. All the phases involved in software development life cycle are very, very important. As you know already, that we are continuously from past few lectures, we are engaged with the software development life cycle and the steps involved in software development life cycle. Just for the sake of reminder, I want to tell you that what is SDLC? It is a software development life cycle, a framework defining tasks performed at each step in the SDLC. As you know earlier, that SDLC consists of certain steps or phases, and each and every step and phase actually involves a set of activities. So this life cycle defines a methodology for improving the quality of software and the overall development process. Any software system can be developed by a software development team, but if they use a proper software development life cycle in order to develop a system or software that would surely improve the quality of that software, because certain steps or phases would be followed in order to develop that software. So that would surely improve the quality. It would surely, in terms of cost or budget, in terms of expertise, in terms of resources, etc. So each and every step would make sure a certain quality, a certain deliverable. SDLC is the structure followed by a development team within the software organization. So who's going to follow the steps or phases of software development life cycle? Of course, the software development team, the stakeholders involved in the software development team, like project manager, system analyst, system software or system architect, developer, programmer or system programmer, the person who is performing coding, so system tester who is performing testing, and operation team. So these are the stakeholders of software development team who will actually follow the steps or phases of SDLC in order to make sure the quality. So SDLC aims to produce quality software that exceeds customer expectations, meets deadlines and cost estimates. So we talked about that SDLC basically improves the quality of software. How it improves the quality of software is that it aims to exceed the customer expectations. SDLC aims to provide the customer with the best software, best output. SDLC makes sure that each and every milestone, each and every activity, each and every phase or step should be completed within the time schedule, within the deadlines, and keeping in view the cost or budget. So it improves the quality. SDLC improves the quality in terms of cost, in terms of deadlines, in terms of users' expectations, and etc., etc. So if we compare our today's lecture with the previous lectures in terms of the coverage percentage, I would say that we are done with the defining phase, we are done with the planning phase, we are done with the feasibility phase, we are done with the analysis phase, we are done with a requirement engineering phase. In total, we are done with, till this moment, we are done with 5 phases of software development life cycle. So basically our today's aim is to discuss and cover the next phase of software development life cycle, which comes after the requirement engineering phase, and this phase is design phase. Keep that in mind. Here there is written design and development, but actually design phase is a separate phase and development phase is separate phase. In design phase, only the layout or design or the architecture for features, for the layout, just the design is prepared. While in development phase, proper coding is done for each and every feature, for each and every interface, etc. So today we are, so our today's objective is to discuss this phase called as design phase. As told you earlier that design phase comes after the requirement engineering phase, and design phase is not at all concerned with coding. Design phase has nothing to do with coding. Design phase is just concerned with preparing the design and front end and the architecture of the layout of the features. So let's start this topic. Design phase is the next step after requirement engineering. So this phase actually helps to bring down the whole knowledge of requirements and analysis on the desk, and it helps the system architect or designer to design the software product. In this phase, system architect can take the help from system or from software specification requirement document from SRS, as the SRS not just states the requirements, it not just tells the requirements, but also the design approach that needs to be followed in the development stage. As told you earlier that in software requirement specification document in SRS, all the requirements are requirements gathered, requirements validated are actually enlisted. So SRS document is used in the design phase by the system architect or software architect. In this phase, product architects will create another document. The deliverable of design phase would be another document called as design document specification. As told you earlier, in analysis phase, or most more suitably we can say that in software, in requirement engineering phase, software requirement specification document was created as a deliverable, while in design phase, a deliverable would be design document specification. This document would be the deliverable of design phase. In the DDS, design document specification, features developed in design phase would be thoroughly described. The DDS must be approved by the customer who actually placed the demand for the software development, and by other stakeholders like the end users, also by the team members of software development team. So usually more than one design approach is proposed in the document, and that is very important point, that more than one design approaches or more than one design strategies or more than one design solutions are proposed in this DDS document. The design phase is basically the architectural phase of system design. The flow of data processing is developed into charts. That is very important, that the data processing is developed into charts. Everything is designed through charts. The project team determines the most logical design, as they have a variety of design approaches. They have different design approaches, and they would choose any one of the most suitable. They would choose one suitable, most appropriate logical design and structure for data flow and storage. DDS includes the best design approach for product architecture, for softwares or systems architecture. DDS document also includes, it involves the risk assessments, product robustness. Product means software or system to be proposed, that product robustness, design, modularity, cost, and timeline constraints. So in DDS document, the best design approach among all the other design approaches, the best design approach would be enlisted, and along with the risk assessments, product robustness, design, modularity, cost, and timeline constraints. So all the stakeholders review this DDS document, this plan, and they offer suggestions after seeing, after reviewing this design document specification, this document. After reviewing all these risks, the best design approach is picked for the product. Now, question is that why in DDS document the best design approach is actually listed along with risk assessments, product robustness and design and modularity, cost and timeline constraints. Why these all things are written in the DDS along with the best design approach? Because the design approach would be chosen as the best design approach if that design approach satisfies the risk, satisfies the robustness, satisfies the modularity, satisfies the cost and timeline constraints. That design would be called as the best design, which actually satisfies all these criterias. So all the stakeholders review this plan and offer suggestions. After reviewing all the risks, the best design approach is picked for the product. During design, the developers and other technical team members will then make decisions about how the system will be designed and built. The inputs from users and information gathered in requirement gathering phase are the inputs of the system. You need to understand that. Again and again, we are saying that software requirement specification document, the SRS document, would be used by the system architect, because SRS document acts as an input for the design phase, because the requirements written in the SRS document act as input for the design phase. The inputs from users and information gathered in requirement gathering phase are the inputs of this step. The goal of design phase is to translate the requirements written into the SRS document into the software design by using this document. Means the ultimate goal of using SRS document is that the requirements written into the SRS document would be translated by the system design into the software design. So SRS document is very, very important. So after, if we again talk about this design phase, we say that after collecting project requirements and by writing these requirements in the requirement engineering phase, the next phase is to design the layout, as well as to design the documents for design phase, where software designs are prepared using the SRS documents. So system designs are prepared using the SRS document in design phase. In this phase, SRS documents, where customer requirements are written, are transformed into a structure that is used as a blueprint for the design phase. This is the architectural phase. We designed the architecture of the system using the SRS document. Means we sketched a blueprint of the project on a paper or on a computer. This blueprint sketching helps the team members for consecutive and systematic work. In other words, system design is the process where we define system architecture, system components, means system features, system modules, system interface, and data of a system using the requirement specification documents. So system design and system design, the architecture is designed, components are designed, modules are designed, interfaces are designed, and data of a system using the requirement specification documents. The various phases using various tools in this design phase, the tools used in order to design the proposed system or software layout or components or modules. These tools can be algorithms, flowcharts, pseudocodes, means sample codes, prototype codes, and ER diagrams, etc. Now, we can say that design phase actually involves, or it consists of, certain set of activities. In design phase, certain activities are performed. What are these activities? In design phase, The first activity which is performed is that integration and designing of the network is done. Networks are designed and designs are made that how the networks would be integrated, would be combined with one another, how they would actually collaborating with one another. The architecture of the application, the architecture of the software, the architecture of the program which the customer wants to get developed. So the architecture of that software or that program is designed, its layout is designed, its user interface means that window on which the features would be displayed, on which the user would be able to perform his tasks, that interface would be designed, the interface which would be used by the user is designed, interface which would be used by the system is designed. Means here the system interface actually means the platform used by that software or system in order to get into working. So that platform, likewise, certain databases which are working at the back end would be designed, and how they would integrate, they would be designed. Likewise, certain prototypes, as we talked about earlier in the prototypes in the requirement engineering phase, likewise in design phase, prototypes are also designed. Here prototype means a sample, not an actual software, not an actual system, but the sample of that system, the sample of that proposed system, sample of that proposed software, the sample, the dummy thing for that proposed system or software. So the prototype would be designed, which and that prototype shows the design details of that system or proposed software. Likewise, layout would be designed for the system controls. System controls are designed, and how they would be integrated, that thing is also designed. So we said that how networks would be designed and how the networks would integrate with one another, that would be designed. So first design activity is design and integrate the network. What does this activity say? In this activity, system design, system designer or system architect would ask that question from himself in order to actually design that activity, that have we specified in detail how the various parts of the system will communicate with each other throughout the organization? So in this network design, this question would be kept in view. This question would be considered, that before designing the network, before designing that the integration of networks, that how the networks would be designed, the question system architect asks would be that how the various parts of the system will communicate with one another. So system or the network would be designed in a way that the system would support the communication of various parts of the system among them, among one another throughout the organization. Another activity is the architecture of application or software program. In this, the system designer or the system architect would ask that, have we specified in detail how each system activity is actually carried out by the people and computers? Means in this activity, in architecture of the application designing activity, system designer or system architect would design the system in a way that he would design, he would specify the details, he would specify, he would design that system, that the system activities could actually, those system activities could be carried out by the people, and those activities could be performed by the computers. Means they would design the architecture of that software, of that system in a way that the computers and the people would be easily able to carry out the activities or carry out the tasks. Then another activity is that user interfaces would be designed. Means system architect would design the proposed system or software in a way in order to make sure that the users will be able to easily interact with the windows of the system or computer, with the interface of the system on which the features or instructions or options are displayed. Then system interfaces would be designed in which the system designer, system architect would specify in detail, would design the system interface in a way that system or that software could easily be able to interact or communicate with other systems inside the organization as well as outside the organization. Then the databases design or integration of the databases would be designed in a way that by this system or software architect that would be easy for the system administrator, database administrator, for the people using that database, that would become easy for them, for this administrator, to store the information needed by the organization. They would actually design a database in a way that it would become easy for the database administrator to store all the information. Then design details are designed, prototypes are designed. While designing the prototypes, system designer, system architect would keep that in mind, that these samples should be able to convey the detailed design decisions in order to make the customer or stakeholders understand that what the original system or original software would look like, because prototype is the dummy, is the sample for the original proposed software or system. So that prototype should be designed in such a way that it should be able to convey the design of the original system or software. Then system controls would be designed, their integrations would be designed in a way that the system designer or system architect would design these things in a way that he would make sure while designing the system controls that the system operates correctly, it responds back to the user correctly, and the data maintained by that system should be safe and secure. So these are certain activities which would be performed in the design phase by the system architect, by the system designer. And these key questions show that while designing these activities, the system architect would keep these questions in mind. He will surely fulfill these tasks while performing these activities in the design phase. So the output of this step comes in the form of two designs. The output of this design phase would be in the form of two designs. Means at the end of this phase, two designs would be designed by the system designer, system architect. One is logical design and another is physical design. They decide on things such as process, these designs, I'm talking about these designs, that they decide on such things such as process, data flow, user interfaces, hardware requirements, etc. Usually design documents are created at this DDS, I'm talking about DDS, that design documents are created at this point that explain how the system will be built. Engineers produce logical diagrams, data flow diagrams, and in some cases pseudo codes, sample codes or sample prototypes, use case diagrams, class diagrams, entity relationship diagrams, entity relationship models, component diagrams, workflow diagrams, activity diagrams, etc. So let's talk about the logical design. I'm talking about the types of system design. So what is a logical design? Logical design pertains to an abstract representation. Abstract. Logical design shows the abstract representation of the data flow, inputs and outputs of the system, that what things can be entered in the system or software, what things would be delivered as the output, what processes would take place as a result of input. So logical design describes the inputs means sources, outputs means destinations, and databases means storage places for data, and procedures like data flows, all in a format that meets the user requirements. While preparing the logical design of a system, the system analyst specifies the user needs at level of detail that virtually determines the information flow into and out of the system and the required data sources. Means the logical design would make sure virtually on paper. You need to understand this, that the design phase is also occurring on paper. Designing is being done on the paper. Then in this phase, all the inputs, that what data would come in, what the data flow would, what type of data flow would come in the system or software, that is flow into, and what data would be generated by the system as output. So all these inputs, outputs, and processes are actually showing the logical design of that system, of that software. Then physical design. Physical design relates to the actual input and output processes of the system. Because logical design was on paper, it was intangible, it was virtual, it cannot be touched, it was all logic. While the physical design is something concrete, tangible, it focuses on how data is entered into a system, how data entered data would be verified. Physical design focuses on how data is entered into a system, how that entered data is verified, how that entered data is processed, and how that data can be displayed as output. So it produces the working systems by defining the design specifications that specifies exactly what the candidate system does. It is concerned with user interface design, process design, data design, and user interface. So user interface defines the ways customers interact with the software and how the software responds to input. It also includes platforms, defines the platforms on which the software will run, such as Apple, Android, Windows version, Linux, or even gaming consoles. So we can say that logical design is an abstract representation of inputs, processes, outputs, and data flows, while physical design is the actual representation of input and output and processes and data flows. Then another type of system design is architectural design. It is also known as high-level design. This design focuses on the design of system architecture. It describes the structure and behavior of the system. Means, as said earlier, logical design is concerned with the abstract representation of input, output, data flow, and interfaces. Physical design is concerned with the actual representation of input, output, processes, and interfaces, while architectural design is concerned with the structure and behavior of the system. It defines the structure and relationship between various modules. Architectural design is concerned with the structure and behavior of the system. It is concerned with the relationship between the modules of different modules of a system or a software development process. Architecture specifies the programming languages to be used in the development phase. It specifies the industry practices, it specifies the overall design, and it specifies the use of any templates. Templates are already, you can say that, pre-built samples. Then another type of a system design is a detailed design. Detailed design follows architectural design and focuses on development of each module. As told you earlier, that architectural phase describes the structure and behavior of the system. It describes the relationship between various modules of the system or of the software, and architectural design also specifies the languages, industry practices, overall design, and the use of any templates. So the detail design is an extension of architectural design. It focuses on the development of those modules which were actually the relationships between those modules was defined by the architectural design, but now these the development of these modules is actually handled by the detailed design step of system design. So for the user interface, the project team designs mock-up screen layouts. Mock-up screen layouts means like prototypes, sample layouts that the developers use to write the code for the actual interface. So these mock-up layouts or prototypes can be further used in the development phase by the coders or by the programmers in order to develop the coding. So prototyping can be a part of the detailed design. Prototyping is actually a part of detailed design. A prototype or mock-up layout, a prototype or a mock, M-O-C-K, mock-up, U-P-up. So a prototype or a mock-up layout is one of the early versions of software in the iterative software development model. Means prototype is not, or mock-up layout is not a proper software, but it is the sample or the earlier version of that proposed system or software. It demonstrates a basic idea. Prototype demonstrates a basic idea of how the system or software can look like and can work. This hands-on design can be shown to the stakeholders, to the customer. Feedback can be used to improve the design of software and the proposed system. Means when that hands-on design, that prototype would be shown to the customer would give some feedback. So that feedback can be further used to improve the design of the application. So it's less expensive to make a change in the prototype. If the customer suggests some changes in the prototype, it is easy to change the prototype. It is easy to make changes in the prototype. System designer, system architect doesn't make a prototype, and after the design phase, this development of that design happens, and in the development phase, customer disapproves the design and customer says, I don't like this feature of the design. Then after development phase, coming back to the design phase and then making changes in the design phase would be a costly thing, would be a difficult thing to do. So prototyping is the process of building a sample model system in terms of information system or in terms of a database system. Prototypes are employed to help system designers build an information system that is intuitive and easy to manipulate and for the end users. So prototyping is an iterative process. Iterative process means that if some suggestion from the customer comes and the customer says that I don't like this feature, kindly change it or add this feature, then prototyping is iterative in the sense that it allows the change. It allows the change repetitively again and again. So it is an iterative process that is part of the design phase. But the prototyping also occurs in the requirement engineering phase. So advantages of prototyping are like prototype reduces the development time. It reduces the development cost. Prototyping requires the user's involvement. It requires the feedback of the customer so that the prototype can afterwards be changed. Its results are higher user satisfaction. And prototypes are an active prototype is an active, not passive model that any user can see, touch and feel. Prototyping can increase creativity because it allows quicker use feedback. which can lead to better solutions. And disadvantages of prototyping are that prototyping often leads to premature commitment to a design. Prototyping can reduce creativity in designs. Prototyping is not suitable for large softwares, large systems, large applications. And structure of the system can be damaged since many changes could be made. And developer misunderstanding of the user objectives can happen. So there are certain advantages as well as certain disadvantages of prototyping. But prototyping is a must. Prototypes are essentially made in the design phase in order to get the feedback from the customer, and prototypes are actually made so that the customer, if dislikes something, if suggests any suggestions, if wants some features to get changed, then the prototype can easily be changed. Then the last type of a system design is conceptual data modeling. Conceptual data modeling is the representation of organizational data, which includes all the major entities and relationships. You already have an idea of entities and relationships you have studied in the database, in databases in first year. Entities are tables and relationships. There are certain types of relationships, binary, unary, and ternary. So you already have familiarity with these concepts. So conceptual data modeling is the representation of organizational data, which includes the entities and relationships. System analysts develop a conceptual data model for the current system, for the existing system, that supports the scope and requirement for the proposed system. That is a noticeable thing, that system analysts develop a conceptual data model for the existing system, which is already installed in the customer's organization. So that data model can support the scope of that system or software which is under development or which is going to be developed, which is the new system. So the main aim of conceptual data modeling is to capture as much as meaning of data as possible. So most organizations today use conceptual data modeling using ER models, ER diagrams, which use special notations to represent as much meaning about the data as possible. You must remember notations like arrows and symbols like that. So we talked about the types of system design: logical design, physical design, architectural design, detailed design, and conceptual data modeling. Now we would talk about two more things: algorithms and flowcharts. Actually, algorithms and flowcharts are the tools and techniques. The logical phase of design phase normally uses these tools and techniques. Means algorithms and flowcharts are the tools and techniques which belong to the logical phase. And you know that logical phase belongs to the design phase. So what is an algorithm? An algorithm is a specific step-by-step procedure for carrying out the solution of a problem. For designing the software, engineers use proven patterns to solve technical problems with algorithms. So algorithm, as told you earlier, is a type of diagram that represents an algorithm or a process. It has certain steps. It is a step-by-step procedure for solving a problem. How? We would know for sure in a span of minutes. So suppose you have been asked to write an algorithm to log in to your Facebook account. That must be interesting for you. Now, if you are asked to log into the Facebook, so what would you do in simple English? You would go to the website of Facebook, www.facebook.com. You would go to this address. Then you would enter your email ID and password in order to get logged into the Facebook, because Facebook would not allow you to enter into your account if you would not give an email ID and password. So you would enter email ID and password into the text box and you would enter into your account. Before entering into your account, you would enter press the enter key, or you would click on the log in button. These are the three steps you would perform in order to get inside your Facebook account, in order to log inside your Facebook account. But how would you write algorithm for these three steps? How would you write an algorithm? So in order to write an algorithm for those three steps for entering into the Facebook account, you would use flowcharts, the symbols of flowcharts, and a pseudo sample code. How? Those symbols, the symbols of the flowcharts would be an oval symbol. That oval symbol will show the start and end of an algorithm. A parallelogram symbol, which would show the input and output operation. A rectangle symbol, which would show the process, that something is in process, something's happening, so that it would indicate the process, such as some mathematical computation process, some variable assignment. And then an arrow symbol, which would show the flow line. These arrows would connect one symbol to another symbol. Then a diamond symbol. That diamond symbol would represent the decision structure. Don't get confused and don't panic. You would be able to understand these algorithms properly and coding things in chapter number 3, but for now you need to just grab the concepts, that what are these flowcharts and how they would be used. So don't panic, these are easy things. So the last would be a connector, a circle symbol, which would be called as a connector, which is used basically in order to join two kinds of algorithms. So these are the symbols of a flowchart, and these symbols would be used in order to write down an algorithm. Now, what is a flowchart? Flowchart is basically, let's talk about the flowchart rules first. Flowchart is generally drawn from top to bottom. All boxes of flowchart must be connected with arrow. I'm talking about the parallelogram and diamond box and rectangle box, which we already discussed in the symbols of flowchart. So all those boxes should be connected with the help of an arrow. All flowcharts must start with a terminal or a process symbol, with a start symbol. Decision symbol have two exit points. One is yes and one is for no. How these rules would apply, I would tell you after a while. So the question was how to write an algorithm in order to log into your Facebook account. As you already know those steps, three steps. The first step was that you logged into you got to www.facebook.com, you got to that website, means you started the process. You have to use that oval symbol in order to show the start of the algorithm. So you would use that oval symbol, and in that symbol you would write down start. It would show the start of the algorithm. Now in parallelogram, as told you earlier, that parallelogram is used to show some input or output process. Now you are entering this website URL, this website address, www.facebook.com, in your URL text box. You are entering this website address. So entering is, and to enter something is called as input. You are giving an input. That's why we have written enter www.facebook.com into a parallelogram. Now these all steps are connected with an arrow. You can see that, and it is going from top to the bottom, and all these symbols are connected with the help of an arrow. Then the next step is that the Facebook homepage would get open. As told you earlier, that the rectangle shows process. Now in rectangle we have written Facebook homepage. Why? Because a process happened. What process happened? That you entered the URL, the web address of www.facebook.com, and as a process, what happened? That Facebook homepage actually that homepage appeared in front of your eyes as a result of some process occurred in the background. So when that Facebook homepage it gets opened in front of your eyes, there a text box would one or two text box will be there, and that homepage will ask you to enter your email ID. It would ask you to enter your password. Up here again, the input is involved. You have to enter some input. You have to enter the input of email ID. You have to enter the input of password. That's why enter email ID and password here is written inside the parallelogram, because parallelogram shows the input. You are giving the input of email ID. You are giving the input of password. Now, there can occur two cases. Either your email ID and password would get approved by the Facebook because your email ID and password is correct. But if you are giving the wrong email ID and password, it would disapprove your data, your input. If your email ID and password is correct, yes, it would. That's why we wrote because your email ID and password is correct. It would happen as a yes, and when your email ID and password is correct, it would open your account box. Your Facebook account would be displayed in front of you, and you can use your email account, your Facebook account. But if you have given the wrong email ID and password, what would happen? It would be a no, and there would occur a login error. You would not be able to enter inside your Facebook account. So the simple English based algorithm was to enter into the Facebook, to give www.facebook.com to log in. A home page would occur, and you have to just give in the email ID and password. But if you need to write down that algorithm by using the flowchart symbols, now on your screen you can see that I have already explained you that how you would be able to use these symbols, some input symbols, some output symbols, some connector symbols, some start and end symbols, in order to write your algorithm. You have to follow the rules of these flowchart symbols. So what is a flowchart? A flowchart is a type of diagram that represents an algorithm or a process. It shows actually the steps of the algorithms with the help of boxes and their order or sequence by arrows connecting the boxes. So flowchart is the diagrammatic representation of the algorithm. It gives a step-by-step solution to a given problem. The operations are represented in these boxes. As you can see that algorithm is starting from top, it is going to the bottom. It is using the flowchart symbols, and these flowchart symbols consist of certain type of boxes, some parallelograms, some rectangles, some diamond shapes, some arrows, but it consists of certain types of boxes. And the operations are represented inside these boxes, and the flow of control is moving actually with these arrows. These flowcharts are used for analyzing, designing, documenting, or managing a process or program in various fields. So most commonly used flowchart symbols have been discussed earlier. So here as an example, I have used this algorithm from your book. Now the algorithm is that you have to write a small algorithm relevant to exam cells working. Like I can give you the example from your book that in the student's examination system development project, the following algorithm will find this algorithm will find the result of a student on percentage marks. You need to write an algorithm which can find out the result of a student, that either that student is passed or either that student is failed, you need to actually use a condition that if marks are greater than or is equal to 40, that means that student is passed. But if that condition is true, marks are really greater than 40 or they are is equal to 40, that student is passed. But if that condition does not get satisfied, means marks are not greater than 40, they are not is equal to 40, marks are less than 40, in that case, the student would be considered as failed. Now, this is the algorithm in simple plain English. Now, you have to place that algorithm in the symbols of flowchart and you have to make a proper flowchart-based algorithm. Now, you have to start the algorithm by using the oval symbol. From here, the algorithm is starting. After the start, you have to give some kind of input. Here, read the marks means input the marks. In programming, you need to get familiar with this term read. Read means input the marks. So, you have to input the marks and as told you earlier, according to the rules of flowchart, for entering the data, you have to use a parallelogram. So, we will input the marks of student using the parallelogram symbol and we will connect all the boxes using these arrows. Then, the condition would be checked. The condition is that you already know that if you want to give a condition based on yes or no, if a condition can be yes, if a condition can be no, that condition can be placed inside a diamond shape, a condition which can be judged on the basis of yes or no, true or false. That condition can always be placed inside the diamond symbol. Diamond symbol is for condition based statement. So the condition is that if marks are greater than or is equal to 40, means if the condition is true, that means yes, that means true, that if the condition is true or yes, that means the student is passed. But the marks you are inputting, the marks you are entering, the marks, if those entered marks are less than 40, that means the condition is no, the condition is false, that means the student is failed. And you have to end that algorithm by using that same oval symbol, because that oval symbol can also be used for start as well as for end. So now we have actually explained this algorithm, which said that you have to find out the result of a student on the basis of a certain percentage. We used that percentage as 40. So we wrote that algorithm by using the symbols of the flowchart in a sequence. Now, if we talk about the deliverable of design phase, the deliverable is system architecture, DDS, detailed design specification document. So system architecture and DDS are created, they are generated as the deliverable of design phase, and DDS and system architecture documents actually they serve as the input for the next phase, for the development, for the coding phase. So dear students, we are done with our today's topic, that is design phase. In design phase, we talked about the types of system design, we talked about the logical design. Logical design is all about the abstract representation of the data flow, inputs, outputs and processes. We talked about physical design, which is the actual representation of inputs, outputs and processes. We talked about architectural design, which is the which describes the structure and behavior of the system, which defines the relationships between the modules of different modules of a system, which specify the programming languages, overall design and use of templates, etc. Then we talked about detailed design. Detailed design follows the architectural design, as architectural design also only shows the relationships between the modules, while the detailed design actually focuses on the development of these modules. So prototyping also occurs in the detailed design. Then we talked about the conceptual data modeling, a type of system design. In conceptual data modeling, representation occurs. It is all about the representation of organizational data, which includes entities and relationships, etc. After the types of system design, we talked about the tools and techniques used in the logical phase of the design phase, which are the algorithms and flow charts. We discussed that how we can write an algorithm in simple English, and then how we can write that algorithm by using the symbols of a flow chart. So dear students, that's the end of our lecture. Hopefully you've got all the concepts. If not, you can ask the questions. We would be available to you. We are available to you at any time, but kindly catch up, listen to these lectures on time. That is very essential. If you are not following the previous lectures, you would not be able to grasp the concepts of the next phases. So we are done for today. Till next lecture, Allah Hafiz.